friends, my friend Anil Bhatti, assembled members of the audience. Yeah, the October Revolution, as everybody knows, was the most ambitious attempt in human history to create a society free of exploitation in which people would collectively shape their own destiny. It is the most significant step in the march of humanity towards freedom from exploitation and from alienation. No matter how we evaluate the events that followed the October Revolution, the fact of its outstanding historic significance is obviously undeniable. Now today, when we look back upon it, the project of human freedom is still with us, and that really requires a theoretical construction, a construction that would make intelligible to us the entire historical journey from the October Revolution to today, and also at the same time clarify for us the conjuncture in which we are placed today. Now, when SAHMAT asked me to actually give four lectures on the October Revolution on the occasion of the beginning of the centenary, I thought I shall make this attempt to theoretically construct the journey from 1917 to today with a view to elaborating, in a sense, the kind of conjuncture in which we live today. Now, I'm aware, of course, of the fact that this is not only an ambitious task, it's an utterly pretentious task. But I take consolation from Antonio Gramsci's remark that every person is a philosopher. Likewise, every person, each and every one of us, is at all the time making this effort to theoretically comprehend what has happened in the interim, and therefore, in a sense, we are all theorists of history. So I'm really not stepping out in some sense from a task in which all of us are engaged anyway, consciously, unconsciously, subconsciously. But on the other hand, I thought I shall just give something which can act as an input to your own thinking. All I can assure you is that what I'm going to say is, whether right or wrong, certainly based on a sufficient investment of effort. Now, this theoretical construction is something which, on which we have to be engaged today, which is absolutely essential for any praxis, and what is more, this theoretical construction also underlay the October Revolution itself. Starting from Marxist theory, there was a development of theory which actually underlay the October Revolution, and the development was up to a level where, as Lukács put it, theory bursts into praxis. So the development of theory from Marx right up to the October Revolution is something which I shall be basically talking about today. There is no doubt that Marxist theory had a profound impact upon Russia, upon intellectual life in Russia. Of course, Marxist theory informed the working class movement in Germany, which was the largest at that time, a movement, the German Social Democratic Party had 86 daily newspapers on the eve of the First World War. It was the largest working class movement anywhere on the continent of Europe. But even though Marxism had that impact on the working class movement in Germany, in terms of the impact on intellectual life, what it had on Russia was really quite outstanding. As you know, the best review of Marx's Capital really was published in Russia. We know from Lenin's own account that during his youth, almost every sensitive intellectual was in some sense influenced by Marxism. We also know that Vera Zasulich wrote to Marx to discuss the possibility of a transition to socialism in Russia from the old commune system, the Mead, whether it was possible to have a transition from Mead to socialism, which was an effort on her part, which was symptomatic of the desire at that time to engage with Marxism in a very serious manner. And Marx's own seriousness in engaging with Russia is manifest from the fact that he actually wrote four different drafts of the letter of the reply to Vera Zasulich, and as Hobsbawm says, that as Marx grew older, his attention shifted increasingly from Western Europe to Russia, where he thought a revolution was more imminent. Now, the debate that took place among Russian intelligentsia, among radical Russian or revolutionary Russian intelligentsia, in terms of the development of Marxist theory, occurred to my mind in at least three different phases. I want to cover three different phases of that debate. The first one was, of course, between the Narodniks on the one hand and the social, you know, it was among the Narodniks on the one hand and the Social Democrats on the other, notably led by Lenin. The Narodnik argument had two quite distinct strands. One of the strands, which was articulated by Vera Zasulich, said that it was not desirable on the part of Russia, which had had a thriving communal life, a thriving life of community, which was represented in the Mir, to pass through the capitalist phase. I should say that all the three theoretical debates, all the three rounds of theoretical debates in Russia were rounds which were basically, in one way or the other, concerned with the question, does a country like Russia have to pass through a capitalist stage? Is it the case that the attempt at socialism in Russia must in some sense depend upon the completion of capitalist development? And if so, what does the term completion mean in this context? Now, the first round, as I said, among the Narodniks, whereas Zasulich's argument was that it was not desirable for Russia to pass through a capitalist stage when it has a certain community life, and it should instead try and make an attempt to make a direct transition from the Mir to socialism, on which, of course, she wanted Marx's advice. The second strand of Narodnik argument was put forward by a person called Danielson, who corresponded with Marx and Engels, who wrote under the name of Nikolayon. And Danielson's argument was that since Russia is characterized by very severe poverty, since the masses in Russia are so poor, the domestic market in Russia is something which is extremely constricted. Russia does not have much access to external markets. It follows, therefore, that Russia cannot even develop capitalism, let alone whether it's desirable or not, that it was simply not possible for Russia to really develop capitalism given the extraordinary narrowness of the Russian market. Now, against these positions, as you know, Lenin's opus, The Development of Capitalism in Russia, argued that, as a matter of fact, capitalism was developing in Russia. And what is more, in order to emphasize the point, he said it's developing daily, hourly. And if capitalism is developing in Russia, then the question which Danielson had posed, that is impossible for capitalism to develop, simply became a non sequitur. And what is more, even the Vera Zasulich kind of argument that is not very desirable became an irrelevant one. Given the fact that capitalism was developing in Russia, then it followed that the proletariat was also developing in Russia, and as the most dynamic class in the Russian scenario, it actually had to take the lead in the social transformation in that country. But in doing so, who were going to be its allies? And that was the debate in the second phase. On the one side, there were people within the Social Democratic Party itself who argued that insofar as Russia was characterized by feudalism, that the Russian Revolution had to overthrow Tsarism and overthrow feudal hegemony, it followed that the proletariat had to actually ally itself with the bourgeoisie, which basically meant that the social democrats in Russia had to ally themselves with the cadets and the liberals led by people like Milyukov in order to carry the revolution forward. Against this, Lenin's argument was something which to this day constitutes a very basic proposition with regard to third world societies and changes in them. That proposition was that in societies which come late to capitalism, the bourgeoisie lacks the will to carry forward a thoroughgoing revolution against feudalism itself. The bourgeoisie lacks the will because it is afraid that any attack on feudal property would rebound into an attack against bourgeois property itself in a situation where it has come late to capitalism and where you find that a revolutionary proletariat has already come into being. Socialism, in short, is in the air. And the fact that socialism is in the air is something which makes the bourgeoisie ally itself with feudal elements. Now, if therefore this is the case in Russia as well, where the bourgeoisie is going to ally itself with feudal elements, for the Social Democrats, which was the name of the Workers' Party at that time, for the Social Democrats to then ally with the bourgeoisie would imply that the democratic revolution cannot be carried forward. It would be a betrayal of the aspirations of the Russian peasantry, which was under the feudal yoke. It followed, therefore, that the proletariat should rather ally itself with the peasantry in order to carry forward the democratic revolution. This Lenin developed in his book, Two Tactics of Social Democracy. And of course, once the proletariat had allied itself with the peasantry in order to overthrow Tsarism and to overthrow the feudal yoke, it's not remained confined to that stage itself and then withdraw quietly, but rather it will carry the revolution forward towards socialism, in the course of which, of course, its allies would change. But the fact is that there was the perception of a continuous revolution taking place in two stages, the first of which was anti-feudal, against Tsarism and Russian feudalism, and the second of it is a carry forward of that towards socialism. And consequently, the Bolshevik program was one which asked for a revolutionary democratic dictatorship of workers and peasants. Now, I think I would like to make a number of comments on this, because I think this represents a very significant development in Marxism. The first comment, of course, I'd like to make is that it, in a sense, carries forward the Narodnik idea, because it says that we don't have to wait in some sense for something called a completion of capitalism, insofar as capitalism's inability or the bourgeoisie's inability to carry the anti-feudal revolution, democratic anti-feudal revolution forward, arises from its fear of the emergence of a revolutionary proletariat, namely that socialism is in the air. It follows that the very emergence of the revolutionary proletariat creates the conditions for something different to happen in history, and that different is that we don't have to wait for some completion of capitalism or capitalist development in any sense. So in that sense, there was a continuity between the Narodnik idea of bypassing capitalism, which of course was not possible, and the Leninist idea, not of bypassing capitalism, but of transcending capitalism without waiting for something called its completion. And of course, at that time, there were a group of Russian intellectuals called the economists. I'm an economist. It doesn't refer to the profession. It simply refers to a group of people who were talking about how rapidly Russia was developing and so on. And Lenin said that actually, with sympathy for the Narodniks, that the Narodniks used to say that that the economists should build a statue to capitalism. And Lenin said how right the Narodniks were, that the economists are forever kind of kowtowing before capitalism. They should probably build a statue to capitalism. The second point I want to make is that, you know, that it actually breaks with the notion of a stage theory, in the sense that there is a view, quite common, that there are different stages of human history, each characterized by a particular mode of production, and when that particular mode of production has run out of its kind of, you know, potential, when it has ceased to develop the productive forces any further, the time becomes ripe for the next mode of production to come on to the stage of history. Now, this kind of view is not what underlies the basic Leninist perception. In fact, many economic historians argue, and they show great surprise by the fact that pre-First World War Russia was showing great increase in GDP, that actually there was a lot of economic growth taking place, and they feel surprised that, you know, if there's a lot of economic growth taking place, then how come that actually at the same time there is an argument being advanced about kind of going beyond capitalism in terms of a revolutionary dictatorship of workers and peasants. Now, obviously, therefore, the notion of a stage in which a mode of production becomes historically obsolete because it cannot develop the productive forces any further. Productive forces being defined in terms of, let's say, the growth of GDP and things of that kind is something that simply did not enter into the Russian revolutionary discourse. Now, it is true that Lenin, of course, in his agrarian program of social democracy, drew a distinction between two paths of capitalist development. One, which he called the American paths, of which France would be also an example, and the other he called the Prussian path. This distinction between two paths has played a very important role in subsequent writings among social scientists, so let me just quickly go over it. The argument was that in countries like the United States, which were unencumbered by feudalism, or in countries like France, in which the bourgeois revolution itself dealt real serious blows to feudalism, you actually have a situation in which the peasantry is therefore, you have a far more vigorous development of capitalism because the peasantry is no longer under a feudal yoke, and as a result you find that the domestic market is much larger, there is a much more vigorous development of capitalism. Compare this to situation, say, in Prussia. The Prussian path of Junker capitalism, which Lenin subsequently, in one of his later writings, called semi-feudal capitalism, is one where capitalism is superimposed on a system in which feudalism is not destroyed. If anything, the feudal lords themselves tend to become capitalists. So you have a combination of capitalist exploitation being superimposed on top of a feudal exploitation. The domestic market remains narrow, and consequently, this takes a very different trajectory as far as development is concerned. Now, the distinction between these two is not a distinction which should be seen in any way in terms of GDP growth rates. Not that countries like countries following the American path experience a faster quantitative growth under capitalism, but the distinction is one which really relates to the qualitative nature of the capitalism that develops. People like Barrington Moore Jr., for instance, have developed the idea that the difference between political democracy and political dictatorship really depends upon the degree to which you are pursuing one or the other of the paths of transition to capitalism. That obviously the Prussian path is one that really predisposes the country much more towards a political dictatorship than the pursuit of the alternative paths. Others have seen the very aggressive imperialist drive of countries like Germany and Japan, which came late onto the historical scene, and therefore where the bourgeoisie did not launch the frontal attack on feudalism of the kind that had happened, for instance, in revolutionary France, as being therefore afflicted by narrow domestic markets and therefore wishing to go out of their own frontiers in order to sustain their capitalist development, and therefore very vigorous imperialist drives. However, you see the infirmities of the late arrival of capitalism. The fact remains that such late arrival of capitalism does affect the nature of capitalist development, but not necessarily in quantitative terms, not necessarily in terms of GDP growth rates and so on. And this never figured in the discussion among Russian revolutionaries. Now, this is a point I shall come back to very shortly. Now, the third and most important aspect of this debate that took place among Russian revolutionaries was, of course, bringing the peasantry to the center of the revolutionary praxis, center of proletarian revolutionary praxis. Now, of course, we had from Marx and Engels' time, the peasant wars in Germany, but the point is that that referred to a different period. In the modern capitalism, the fact that a transition to socialism can actually rely upon the revolutionary strength of the peasantry was a completely new idea as far as Marxism was concerned. Marx had really, and Engels had talked about revolution in India, I mean, you know, revolution in third world countries. But that revolution and its relationship with the revolution that was supposed to be occurring in Europe in terms of a transition to socialism under the aegis of the proletariat, those two had remained unconnected. The fact that in countries coming late to capitalism, the fact that the bourgeoisie cannot complete the anti-feudal democratic revolution, and therefore the revolutionary advance has to be made by the proletariat together with the peasantry, and that this in turn can lead on to the development of socialism. This whole idea that you can actually have in one part of the globe a transition to socialism, because the democratic revolution, the democratic tasks have been to a very significant extent achieved, and another part of the world you can actually have, again led by the proletariat, a democratic revolution that leads on to socialism. And consequently, there is a universalization of the revolutionary project, which now has a certain coherence, taking the world as a whole. This was an altogether new, novel idea. And this is something which has actually remained with the revolutionary movements in third world countries. And this is something which later on was, for instance, conceptualized in terms of People's Democratic Revolution, New Democratic Revolution in China, and such like. The fourth aspect of this, which I'd like to discuss, which I think is quite important, is that, you know, the perception was not simply opportunistically taking advantage of the peasantry, that here's a disgruntled peasantry, and therefore the proletariat can take advantage of the disgruntled peasantry in order to have its own tasks more or less resolved. But it was actually, in some sense, relying on the peasantry as a revolutionary force, as a potentially revolutionary force, in which there is the presumption that the proletariat can actually be an ally. The proletariat can have as its allies significant sections of the peasantry in the march to socialism itself through transitional intermediate forms like cooperatives, collectives, and so on. Obviously not the peasantry as a whole, but a substantial element of the peasantry can actually be won over to the cause of socialism. Now, this was a new idea. It was a new idea because this didn't figure in Marx. Perhaps it didn't figure in Marx because, as you know, during the Paris Commune, the peasantry was opposed to the communards. That's because of the fact that the French Revolution had already in a sense, distributed feudal lands among the peasants and created this vast mass of petty peasant proprietors. And Thiers, who was the leader of the anti-communard group, the political leader of the reactionary segments of the French bourgeoisie, therefore put forward the idea that an attack on bourgeois property, such as what the commune is proposing, would also be an attack on petty peasant property. And therefore, it will be an attack on private property as a whole, and therefore the peasantry must not support the Paris Commune. And a major reason for the defeat of the Paris Commune was that the peasantry did not support the commune and went over to the side of Thiers and the bourgeoisie. So, in a sense, the reactionary nature, potentially reactionary nature of the peasantry must have been apparent and weighed on Marx's mind. And I think, therefore, the Russian debate, which highlighted the potentially revolutionary role of significant sections of the peasantry, represented a new novel advance as far as Marxist revolutionary theory is concerned. It is in that sense, therefore, made Marxism, it in that sense, therefore, made Marxism from simply a view of a possible European revolution into a universal revolutionary doctrine. Not universal revolutionary doctrine only in the trivial sense that since capitalism is spread all over the world, a theory of capitalism is critical of it, like Marxism, must also therefore relate to all over the world, but actually informing the revolutionary praxis all over the world, though this praxis itself may differ from one location to another. It is in that context that the third round of the debate among Russian revolutionaries and so on really became important. And that round of the debate said that not only is a world revolution, not only is Marxism therefore given the role not only the possibility of Marxism informing a world revolutionary praxis recognized, but what is more, the time for such a praxis has arrived. And that was at the time of the First World War. Now, as you know, the First World War brought forth alternative reactions as far as the socialist movement was concerned. There were three broad kind of positions on it. One, which was referred to as the social chauvinist position, which actually said that we must support our own country in this war. The other, which was a middle position taken by Kautsky, Martov, and others, which actually said that we cannot support the aggressive designs of our countries, but if the country is being attacked, then we have to defend the country. So in a sense, it's a kind of middle position. The third was a position which was taken by the revolutionary wing of the European Socialists, which said we must oppose the war. Which is not to say that the third position was unanimous about how to oppose the war. Rosa Luxemburg, for instance, argued in terms of a pan-European working class movement for peace, while Lenin actually argued in terms of converting what he called the imperialist war into a civil war, that actually used this war to overthrow the yoke of the bourgeoisie. And no matter what the difference is between Lenin and Luxembourg, the fact remains that they constituted the revolutionary wing of the European left, which came together in two conferences, Zimmerwald and Kienthal, in order to put forward an alternative agenda. And likewise, there are differences. Rosa Luxemburg's position about the war was informed by her theory of imperialism, which Lenin rejected, and so on. But nonetheless, there was a general position of opposition to the war. And as you know, Karl Liebknecht, who was a German deputy, voted against the war credits in the German Reichstag. Now, Lenin's position on this was, of course, derived from a certain reading he had of imperialism. And that reading said that, look, the immanent tendencies of capitalism in the form of centralization of capital occurring in the spheres of banking, in the industry, and so on, ultimately bring to the fore a few monopolists who then constitute an oligarchy amongst themselves. There is a fusion of banking and industrial capital. A few people preside over banks and industries. They constitute the financial oligarchy as far as that country is concerned. This financial oligarchy has again very close relationships with the state and is engaged in competition with rival financial oligarchies. In other words, having monopoly gets rid of competition in the form of price cutting among the producers, as happened in the period of free competition. But on the other hand, what it does, I mean, you have cartels, for instance, which fix prices. But what it does is that it actually carries competition on to a much higher level, where you have rival financial oligarchies fighting against one another in order to acquire what Lenin called larger economic territory. Sources of raw materials, markets, sources of potential raw materials, and so on. And of course, in a situation like this, when there's this quest for economic territory, if the world is already divided, then of course only a repartitioning of the world is possible, which of course those who came late onto the scene of capitalism, like Germany, would be more keen on effecting. And this, therefore, is bound to lead to wars among them. Even if there are periods in which there is peace and mutual agreement among these different financial oligarchies, since uneven development of capitalism is always changing relative strengths of these oligarchies, sooner or later, therefore, you would once more get into a situation of war. So his argument was that a period of imperialism, which capitalism had entered into, necessarily entails periodic wars for dividing and redividing the world. These wars offer the workers in these countries only a choice between two options. One option is to kill fellow workers across the trenches. The other option is to actually turn your guns on the system itself and overthrow the system. And therefore, in a certain sense, the fact that the system had become historically obsolete is manifest in the stark choice which it gives to the workers. And likewise, Lenin argued that, you know, in colonies, in third world countries, whose people are drawn into these wars as cannon fodder, the fact that they are given military training, the fact that it also widens their own horizon and understanding of the world, would mean that those people also would now increasingly come in to the revolutionary stream, world revolutionary stream. It followed, therefore, that now a period of historical obsolescence of capitalism and therefore a period of world revolution had arrived. Now, I think this is something which represents a remarkable break. Let me just go back a little. That typically, when Edward Bernstein, the well-known German leader, had argued as follows. He had argued, in line with this notion that productive forces, the system cannot develop productive forces anymore, and that's when we can say that it has become obsolete. His argument had been that this would manifest itself in terms of a crisis, in terms of a stagnation, in terms of some economic marker. Capitalism has had no such economic marker. There is really no kind of obvious crisis or, you know, whatever, stagnation or anything of that kind, no absolute immiserization. So it follows, therefore, the system has not become obsolete, and there is no prospect of its becoming so in the foreseeable future, and therefore the workers should try and get whatever they can, improve their material condition within the system rather than thinking in terms of overthrowing the system. Now, against this position, this position which meant revising Marxism, from which the term revisionism comes, against this position, the revolutionary position in German social democracy, which was argued by people like Franz Mehring, Clara Zetkin, Rosa Luxemburg, Karl Liebknecht, and others, basically argued, certainly Rosa Luxemburg's argument, which was theoretically supported by her theory of imperialism, said yes, capitalism may not actually have had a crisis, but the very process of accumulation is such that it actually must eventually lead to a collapse. Not that she visualized that it's going to collapse day after tomorrow, but the fact that she postulated a collapse as a theoretical limit point of capitalism, because of which, long before you reach the limit point, the proletariat would have actually overthrown the system, and the very fact of moving towards this limit point would engulf you in wars. That's the way she explained the First World War and so on. But Lenin's argument really broke both with the Bernstein kind of revisionism and also the Rosa Luxemburg's own revolutionary positions, and it actually argued that, look, the historical obsolescence of capitalism doesn't manifest itself in terms of any economic markers, that it is something which arises from the fact that the proletariat increasingly is faced with this choice that, you know, in a situation of wars into which imperialism throws mankind is increasingly faced with this choice of either overthrowing the system or having to kill fellow workers across the trenches. Therefore, the argument was that a conjuncture had arisen in which world revolution was on the agenda. Now, if that was the case, then of course, and obviously that was a product of inter-imperialist rivalry, and Lenin also argued that inter-imperialist rivalry, the fact that they could not be together, is also what enabled those countries like Russia, like the Soviet Union, which had broken out of capitalism to survive. Even in one of his last writings, he says that you know, the reason the Soviet power survives is because of the contradictions, the rivalry among the imperialist countries, even though it's the case that several of them had got together to attack the Soviet Union, as you know. Nonetheless, he therefore saw that this was a conjuncture in which it was possible for countries to break off one after another from this from the world capitalist system, and what is more, the rivalries among the capitalist powers can even sustain such breaking away, because they can't really combine to overthrow such breakaways. What then constituted the obstacle to revolution? If it is the case that the situation is ripe, the conjuncture is favorable, then it turns out that, really speaking, the absence of revolutionary praxis must arise because of the fact that significant sections of working class leadership could not recognize it that way. Significant sections of the working class leadership did not see the revolutionary possibilities within this conjuncture. And if so, if you are going to wait till they have seen this, then you would be missing a historic opportunity. It followed, therefore, that it's become very important, if necessary, to go it alone. Now, you know that it was not only the right Mensheviks, but even someone like Julius Martov, who was a very, you know, I mean, whom Lenin was very fond of, who had been his friend since the old Iskra days, was really opposed to the Bolshevik Revolution. And why Julius Martov, Zinoviev and Kamenev had been opposed to the Bolshevik Revolution. The bulk of the Central Committee of the Bolshevik Party itself had been opposed to the Bolshevik insurrection, at which point Lenin had said that I'm going to take it to the rank and file. So the point is that the idea of making a united front with elements who are vacillating is going to tie your hands down. It's going to allow the historic opportunity to really move away from you, you know, that you'll miss. And therefore, it behoved a revolutionary to go it alone if necessary in a situation where this united front is going to work against, or by united front, I mean, you know, having allies, having friends, you know, waiting for others to come over to your point of view might actually make you miss the opportunity. This was something which was not only true as far as Russia was concerned, but it is something which even happened at the level of the international. As you know, apart from the Second International, Kautsky and Martov had set up an alternative international which was referred to as a 2.5 international, because they were much closer in some sense to the Bolshevik position than the Second International had been. It's a kind of middle position. But Lenin said we must have nothing to do, not just with the Second International, but also with the 2.5 international, because it's going to tie our hands down. Now, this idea is, of course, something which is understandable. But it had two implications which I want to draw your attention to. The first implication, of course, is that there were many countries in which, even in this conjuncture, the revolutionary attempt, if made, might fail. And in fact, in Germany, it did fail. And outstanding revolutionaries like Rosa Luxemburg, Karl Liebknecht, Eugene Levine, they were all executed in the process of carrying out this revolutionary task in Germany, failure after failure of the German Revolution. Walter Benjamin traced the emergence of fascism to the failure of the German Revolution. But in such a case, what happens then? At what point then you decide that, look, revolution is not working out, and it becomes important to form united fronts with others in order to keep the fascist forces at bay, which actually had become and rose to prominence in the 30s. Now, this is something which, of course, in the 7th Congress of the Communist International in 1936, the idea was that there has to be a united front against fascism, but that was rather late. But I would believe that to some extent, the fact that there was a reticence in forming alliances with other political forces owed to this understanding that is going to hold back the revolution. And this understanding persisted even after the revolution had actually failed. The second aspect of this, which I want to again draw your attention to, is the fact that if you say that go it alone, okay, go it alone may be a contingent historical necessity. But go it alone does imply that a situation may arise in which the dictatorship or the proletariat gets converted to a one-party dictatorship, the party that actually decides to go it alone. Now, it arises because of a historical contingency. But subsequently, it was actually theorized by Stalin to say that, look, every class has to be represented by one party. It followed, therefore, that the proletariat had to be represented by one party, and therefore the dictatorship of the proletariat necessarily meant a dictatorship of the party, which was making a theoretical virtue of a contingent historical necessity. And consequently, it is something which had a very important role in the fact that subsequently the proletariat in the Soviet Union got depoliticized, and that was a major factor why. And a kind of new form of alienation, not alienation that you find in the capitalism, but alienation of a different kind, crept into society, and therefore that was ultimately, in my view, the cause of the defeat or the collapse of the Soviet Union and the cause of the setback to socialism. Now, these are some of the issues which I'm going to cover in subsequent lectures, but I would just like to mention one point here, that in the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, Marx drew a distinction between bourgeois revolution and proletarian revolutions. Bourgeois revolutions, he said, are brilliant. They have a dazzle about them. They're kind of dazzling historical processes. While a proletarian revolution must be much more kind of plodding, much more kind of, pedestrian in some sense. Why? Because the aim of the proletarian revolution is not to bring some kind of a new property class into power, but to destroy class rule itself. And if that is the case, then a proletarian revolution can actually succeed only when the people as a whole are involved. And of course, involving the people as a whole is something that takes time, is something which is slow, ponderous, and consequently it lacks the dazzle of the bourgeois revolutions. Now, the Bolshevik Revolution, of course, had a dazzle. It was a dazzling phenomenon. In fact, you know, I mean, Hobsbawm talks about the fact that for weeks and months, Europe was absolutely stunned by this fact that there was this revolution which had happened in what later became the Soviet Union. It had a dazzle. That dazzle, while it was, of course, part of an enormous impact on the world, was in a sense also a weakness of the revolution, because you know it really went against this idea of the people as a whole being involved in it in a way which actually would be far more time-taking, far more ponderous and so on. Of course, the fact of this revolution being having a universal significance is something which is very obvious. Quite apart from anything else, the Soviet Union, it has nothing to do with the collapse of the Soviet Union. The fact remains that the October Revolution created the conditions. It created the Soviet Union, which was essential not only for the defeat of fascism, it was essential for decolonization of the Third World, and it also built up the most gigantic welfare state the world has ever seen. No matter how much of a critic you may be of the October Revolution, of the socialist project that was carried out in the Soviet Union, these historic tasks that it's achieved are absolutely undeniable. I spent my salad years at the University of Cambridge. I was teaching there briefly. Professor Joan Robinson used to say, whenever there was, and you know, this was sort of 60s, late 60s, early 70s, whenever people really talked harshly of the Soviet Union, she would say, yes, but don't forget, but for the Soviet Union, we wouldn't be sitting here talking like this. In other words, the defeat of fascism was above all a contribution of the Soviet Union. Of course, it had all its limitations, which we know the Soviet Union collapsed. From the fact of its collapse, some people then argue, which I believe is absurd, that it would have been better if the revolution had not taken place. On the contrary, this revolution had enormous achievements to its credit. And of course, the point now is to learn our lessons from it. It played its role in history, and of course, we as students of history have to learn our lessons from it. Thank you very much.